James Pryor's last job was tough enough, battling with the problems of employment. Now he faces problems that are even more obstinate as Secretary of State for Northern Ireland. TVR reporter Liew Gardner has been in Belfast, watching the Protestants on the move and talking to James Pryor. What does Britain do next?
Secretary of State, I've met many in this province, most of them Protestants, but some of them Catholics, who live literally in fear of their lives. What are you going to do to remove that fear?
I think that perhaps the new phenomenon in recent months has been that that fear is shared by both Catholics and Protestants. And this means that we ought to have a much better chance of getting on top of violence and terrorism, because the whole community, both Catholics and Protestants, are now prepared and should be prepared to come forward with information which up to now has been shielding quite a few of those who are committing acts of violence. So I hope that by a combination of certain new measures, a higher profile, but particularly more undercover operations, that in this way we can defeat terrorism.
In the wake of the latest wave of IRA killings, Jim Pryor was under intense pressure to step up security, to hit back. He responded to the call by increasing the visual display of armed force on the border with the South and throughout Northern Ireland. The border badlands. Here, as in other parts of Ulster, there is talk and more of a third force of Protestant activists to hit back at the IRA. Such moves rekindle old Catholic fears. And at the same time, isolated farmers are neither impressed nor reassured by Jim Pryor's security drive. For them, there is fear in the very hedgerows. One farmer spoke of that fear.
You farm around here?
Yes, just up the road a few miles.
It's nervous times for you.
Very nervous, very nervous. This is the second UDR funeral inside a week.
This man was born here and farms these hills, but he would prefer that some of his neighbours do not see him talking to TVI.
You're just in the very suburbs of IRA country. There's a lot of the people we're meeting along the road that I'd rather didn't see that I was doing this.
Why is that?
Because a lot of them would be IRA supporters and would tell the IRA what was going on. It's always in your mind, you're just wondering what's going to happen next. You get lulled for a few months, the security forces disappear, there's no trouble, and you know that the build-up's coming again, and you're just sitting on your nerves waiting to see who's going to be shot for.
Protestants in particular, however, simply do not believe that the fight against the IRA is being pursued with the vigour and the determination required.
Well, I know that that's what they don't believe, and they come and tell me that. And I ask them for further things that they believe we ought to be doing. But I always stress that what we have to do must be within the law, because if we move outside the law, then I think we shall find, as other countries have found, that you don't solve the problem, you get into even more difficult problems.
You see, if I may interrupt, sir, they feel, of course, that you're doing it within the law with kid gloves on. They feel, and I think you were in church the other day when a minister said it, that there is a war going on here. And they want positive rather than passive policies, don't they?
No, but they're not passive policies in any way. And you go down onto the border and you see that they're not passive policies. And if you see or hear of the operations of some of the special groups that are operating, they're not passive policies either. But we do have to act within the law. We have to act within the law when it comes to interrogation. We have to act within the law when it comes to charging people with offences and bringing them to the courts. Now, that is the way that we have always done it, and that is the only self-respecting way that we can continue to do it.
If security is not stepped up, or if positive results are not obtained, or more positive results are not obtained, isn't the danger that the Protestants, the so-called third force, will take the law into their own hands?
Well, that, I think, would achieve nothing, because that would just create a lawless society, and that would certainly drive the Catholic minority right back into the arms of the terrorists all over again. So that would again divert security effort which is needed to defeat the terrorists into doing other things. I don't regard that as any answer at all. But if there are people who want to come forward with information and want to come forward with help, let them do so. If there are people from Dr. Paisley's particular party who are not members of the UDR or not members of the constabulary, let them come forward and volunteer, and we'll see whether we can increase the numbers there. But apart from that, it is a matter of covert operations, undercover operations, which are as effective as anything else, although it also means we have to keep a higher profile as far as the military and the police are concerned to convince the public that we mean business.
You're a farmer, Mr. Prower. You know something of farmers' mentality. If half a dozen Suffolk farmers around you had been shot dead in the last few weeks, no one arrested, wouldn't you be talking with your friends and your fellow farmers about taking the law into your own hands, about protecting yourselves?
Well, I think the answer to that, again, is what I would be doing is making quite certain that the information that is available about this, and of course, if you're a farmer, you know everything that moves in your area. Nothing can take place in your area without you knowing. You know where the holes and the hedges are. You know the little tracks across the borders and so on. The difficulty is, I found out when I was down on a border the other day from two groups of patrols which were going round, was that when they go from farmhouse to try to find the, to get information, they're either met with a perfectly cordial reception but no information, or the doors are not even open to them at all. Now, of course, this is fear and this is intimidation. And until we can defeat that, it is very hard to root out the terrorists.
Robert Bradford's coffin was barely in the ground before Ian Paisley held an impromptu press conference. Here, mourning the dead and propaganda walked together to the graveyard.
Mr. Bradford's guard had a pea shooter, a man that shot Mr. Bradford, and his friend, his constituent, Ken Campbell, had a machine gun. Why should an officer of the law stand with a helpless with a pea shooter? There are many weapons in our armory, very effectual weapons, and these will come into play if the British government doesn't have sense. We also will have a third force. We will have men on the streets of Northern Ireland who will give us...
How many men do you command?
I wouldn't be prepared to give you an answer to that.
What do they do?
You mean what do they do when they are on patrol?
That's right, yes.
We have a local village here, very similar to many of the hamlets in County Fermanagh, and we will simply patrol the perimeter of the village, stopping all traffic on the roads, identifying who it is that's travelling.
What if they refuse to stop?
They will stop.
Paraded in Newtownards, the Third Force resembled a cross between a football crowd and the Ulster Division of Dad's Army. Yet menace hung in the cold night air, and the Reverend Foster knows exactly what he is about.
How will you make them to stop?
Well, I would prefer not just to say how we will make them stop, but they will stop.
Will your men be armed?
There is in the north of Ireland, under license, quite a number of sporting weapons, shotguns, rifles, and I would say there's a due proportion of those weapons in County Fermanagh legally held by members of the Third Force. So it's very possible that they will be armed. I was asked on another occasion what would happen if we encountered an IRA active service unit, as they like to term themselves. And suffice for me to say that that would be the last bit of active service that they would carry out.
This is a very solemn occasion. It is solemn because many of us here who are gathered in this square tonight will have to leave down our lives to give our children the freedom that they deserve. Well, the killing of the IRA is over!
Paisley is certainly the loudest of Protestant voices, but others, quieter and more reasonable, have their fears. Official Unionist Harold McCusker.
The majority of people in Northern Ireland, irrespective of what they hear from Paisley or anyone else, feel in their bones, because we're very sensitive to this, of course, feel in their bones that they're being betrayed, that the Anglo-Irish dialogue is an effort to, over a long term, gradually nudge us out of the United Kingdom all into an All-Ireland Republic. The Whitehall establishment has decided that to tidy up the United Kingdom and to tidy up Europe and to no doubt establish a relationship with the island on their western seaboard, Northern Ireland is dispensable.
Mr. McCusker, who's perhaps not one of the wild men, nevertheless thinks that the British government has decided that in the long run, Ulster is dispensable. Is Ulster dispensable?
He has drawn totally wrong conclusions. Ulster is not dispensable. And if one thinks of the efforts, both in terms of the economy and in the terms of our soldiers from Great Britain, all that we have done for Ulster in the last few years, I would have thought it was an absolute indication of our determination to see that Ulster prospers and to see that Ulster lives in peace. And as long as Ulster wishes to remain a member of the United Kingdom, so that will maintain and be maintained.
There are, on the face of it, only three routes, are there not? The independence favoured by some Protestants that could lead to civil war, a determined effort to bring reunification of Ireland, which you say isn't on, which would surely in any case cause a Protestant rebellion, and yet another attempt at power sharing in the knowledge that every such attempt in the past has failed. So where do you go, Secretary of State?
I think there are a number of things we can do. I personally think that independence is no answer for the people of Ulster. I think that if they were not supported by Great Britain, and I think they have every right to be supported by Great Britain, but I think without that support, the province simply could not exist as a reasonably prosperous society. And so I certainly don't think that that is a possibility. I do think that much closer economic links with the South could be of help. But in some directions, we are a competitor of the South. In other directions, like Kinsale oil and interconnectors for electricity, better tourist arrangements, better agricultural arrangements, I think there is a great deal more that can be done there. What I need to see is a third thing, is what further progress towards some form of political devolution for the North, and I stress for the North, is possible. Now, I believe that perhaps through all the tribulations and the very considerable seriousness of the last few days, that there are many people who now, having perhaps looked into the abyss, will want to see some satisfactory form of devolved government operating in Northern Ireland. And that is what we shall be working very hard to achieve. In fact, even during these last few days, when we've had the enormous pressures of the security problem to deal with, we have still been searching and looking at papers and discussing amongst ourselves and amongst other people how we might move forward on the devolution side.
Another plan. So many things have been tried since William of Orange first landed in Ireland at Carrickfergus. There are economic problems here, but the local council announces they will cold shoulder Jim Prior and the British government. Yet, as factories close, it seems that there can never have been a greater need for help from the mainland. Even the local power station development has been curtailed. Carrickfergus, like Northern Ireland, is running down. Unemployment in Ulster runs at 19%. In Carrickfergus, the job centre, protected by a high wire fence, is the bleak meeting place for jobless men and youngsters. A Catholic club in the Short Strand district of Belfast. In Ulster, the bazaar is commonplace. A television camera scans each caller. Like every other visitor, I had to stay beyond the Colditz-like high wire fence until the security guard was prepared to check me through. It is an added indignity for those hit by poverty and unemployment. Inside, it seems as if a snooker game is never ending. There is little else to do. Unemployment among Catholics is twice as great as among Protestants. And here, as on the borders, there is real fear. Two of the unemployed.
I was talking to John earlier on. It's not life. It's only existing here. You're not living. There is no life. You can't leave your doors at night. The doors is locked. Anybody that comes to the door, a neighbour, you want identification to find out who they are before the doors is open. This has been going on for years, really, in the short stand. But now, at the head of the troubles, the way they're coming up, it's got worse and getting worse. People's going out on the street tonight just storming around and making sure that there's no cars, motorbikes that's going to fly past and open up on them.
So why would you rather stay? Why would you rather stay in a place?
Well, I was born and reared in the area. My children have been born and reared in this area. It's only from the troubles and the way they're escalating at the present moment with the shootings and the assassinations.
There was no sympathy for Protestants with similar fears, just a litany of grievance.
But the reason why, is my way of thinking anyway, because there was no work. The Catholics was getting no work. The workforce in Northern Ireland was all comprised of Protestant industries.
So for both of you, what you want from Jim Pryor is security and work?
Yeah, most Catholics would look for.
In the economy, of course, Mr. Pryor, have you seen how people live in, say, the Short Strand, seen their homes, seen the unemployment? It's a desperate situation, isn't it, for many people here, leaving the security out of it?
Well, I don't think you can leave the security out of it, because I think that the security and the level of the economy are very much bound up together. Even if you had no security problem here, you would be probably having some degree of violence whilst you have the poverty and the unemployment that Northern Ireland is suffering from at the moment.
Did it shock you when you came here?
Yes, it did, and I said so quite plainly. And you see, the problem is that it is not improving. It's getting worse, if anything. And it's getting worse for a number of reasons, partly because a lot of the old industries are suffering, partly because some of our best people are leaving Northern Ireland, young people who are of university standard, quite a few of them go over to the mainland for university and don't come back. And lastly, because the more that the unrest lasts, the more reluctant people are to invest here. Even people who live here are becoming more reluctant to invest here, yet alone money coming in from America and from other countries. So we have to get over our problems in a political and security manner if we are to make economic progress.
You came here, Mr. Pryor, you born and raised in the east coast of England. You could hardly be further away from here. Did you really understand it before you came? Do you think people in Britain understand what's happening here? Does the cabinet understand what's happening here?
I think it's very hard for an Englishman to understand Northern Ireland. And I think this has been proved if one reads a number of books over the past, which have been written about Ireland, Northern Ireland in particular, over the past 300 years. And of course, one does take that precaution of trying to steep oneself in the history. Having said that, I find that the most of the people one meets over here are the most genuine and attractive people. And I think there is a lot going for Northern Ireland, if only we could somehow...
Dr. Paisley among those genuine,
well,
and attractive people?
Every, I'm not making any comment about individual people, the last thing I want to do, but the vast majority of people here are decent people who want to get on with the job, who want to see the two communities working more closely together, who understand the problems that the economy is now suffering from and recognising that it is still on the slide.
Jim Pryor's crash course in Irish history has left at least one border farmer unimpressed.
What do you think of Jim Pryor? Do you think he understands you?
I don't think he understands the Ulster Protestant either. I think it's a job he got stuck with and that was it. He might try and make a show for a while, but he doesn't understand it at all.
But how do moderate Catholics view Jim Pryor? Do they share the deep suspicion felt by their Protestant neighbours? John Hume.
No, I don't. In fact, I think that he arrived here in the most difficult possible circumstances for any Secretary of State, and in worse than any of his predecessors. He arrived here towards the end of the hunger strike, which had deeply polarised the community. He arrived at a time when the Provisional IRA have escalated their campaign in a most vicious way to provoke sectarian reaction from the Protestant community. And he arrives against a background of 20% unemployment, the highest in our history, and an economy almost in a state of collapse. That's a tall order for any man, in my book, to face that type of situation.
The Northern Ireland Post is surely the toughest job in British politics, a graveyard for ambition. Jim Pryor has been Secretary of State for 10 weeks. It has been a rough start. Perhaps things can only get better, although that is not usually the way of the world in Ulster. He made his name as a conciliator, a healer of wounds. In Northern Ireland, the wounds are deep.
Every new man in a job wants to make changes, impose his own style. What changes will you make in Stormont? What is your style? What is going to be the Jim Pryor style in Northern Ireland?
My style here is exactly the same as my style throughout my political career. I believe, wherever possible, in trying to get people to work together, to live together in peace and prosperity. And that is my style here. And in order to reach that goal, there will be some rough and difficult decisions to take on the way. But again, I believe that that has to come about, as far as this country is concerned, by a combination of more forthright activities on security, and I put that very much at the top. The last week has driven that point home in no uncertain fashion, followed as well by economic progress and some devolvement of decision-making from Westminster and from, as it were, the government to the people of Northern Ireland through their own elected representatives.
When you took the job, you said you were prepared to put your political reputation on the line to try to bring peace to Northern Ireland. Will your political reputation survive? Will there be peace?
Well, it doesn't actually, doesn't matter very much whether my political reputation survives or not. The important thing is that Northern Ireland should survive, and the people of Northern Ireland should have confidence that I'm seeking to do what is right and in their best interests.
Will that happen?
And this is what, after a period of time, I believe that I can accomplish. At any event, that is what I set out to do, and I shall be judged accordingly, and I'm quite happy to be judged accordingly.